not knowing any of this.
Could have passed him. It's a small world, after all, isn't it?
So, what was Dad like?
He was a quiet man, but and with like a dry sense of humour, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
He was very intelligent.
Yeah, he was an intelligent man. His dad, then, that's his passport photo, that is.
Wow.
So what was Dad in then, in the army?
Royal Army Service Corps. I mean, it was all over.
Yeah.
You know, Hong Kong, Singapore, Germany.
I was in the RAF regiment. And that was me many moons ago.
Good God. Gosh. Oh, yeah.
It's funny that I should go down the road of joining the military, not knowing my father was in the army, but it's nice to have that common bond.
I'm so lucky because I've now got blood family, you know. I just can't get over it.
No.
I really can't get over it.
There is a connection now, so I'm over the moon, really. We look forward now, don't we?
Yeah.
Now I know where I come from. I never had them before, but I've got them now.
Next time, a man found opposite an underground station 70 years ago.
Who left me here? Don't know.
And much more recently, a woman discovered as a newborn baby on the steps of a tower block.
This is where I was abandoned.
A new long-lost family born without trace continues tomorrow night at 9. Then this Thursday night at 8:30, a galaxy of stars come together to celebrate the remarkable achievements of young people who've overcome extraordinary barriers. Anton Deck hosts the Prince's Trust Awards. Next, the ITV News at 10.
Ancestry sponsors Real Life Stories on ITV.
Up another big hike on energy bills. Some help, though, could be coming. And 14 children have been shot dead in an American school.
Hear every moment of summer. Book your free hearing check at bootshearingcare.com and save 15% off our best-selling hearing aids. Boots, with you for life.
Ocado's got 3 for £10 on your barbecue favourites. And with £20 off your first shop, there's an Ocado just for you.
If you're serious about renting out your property, find out what it would let for instantly. Enter your postcode now for a free online valuation estimate. Get real about renting. Get on the market.
Electric car insurance from LV. Run out of power and we'll take you to the nearest charge point or charge you roadside. Get a quote today at lv.com.
If constipation makes your day feel offbeat, take Fibergel every day. It harnesses the power of fibre to help you get back to regularity. Find your groove with Fibergel. And to help keep you regular, try new Fibre Chews.
Lemons. Lemons, lemons, lemons. Look how nice they are. The moment you become an Expedia member, you can instantly start saving on your travels.
Savannah, have a juice!
So you can go and see all those lovely, lemony lemons.
I can only maya here.
And never wonder if you got a good deal. Because you did.
All the latest now. Here's the ITV News at 10.
Another shock to the cost of living, energy bills to rise by £800 in October, on top of the £700 hike last month. And just as winter sets in, a stark warning from the regulator, it'll double the number of families struggling.
frankly, I'm scared. I don't know where cash is going to come in to go and support that sort of thing.
As pressure mounts on the government to do something and fast, Robert has learned a £10 billion package of help could be on its way. He'll join us shortly, also on News at 10. After the Downing Street photos we brought you last night, at last, Sue Gray's report is coming tomorrow. Can the PM survive it? Also breaking tonight in the US, 14 children and their teacher dead in a school shooting in Texas. The massive data leak revealing the horrors of China's Uyghur detention camps. A frightening rise in the children getting hepatitis and why COVID could be behind it, and... ABBA's avatars have their back on stage without even leaving home.
It's like witchcraft. The fact that you can be on stage at the same time as you're out home walking the dog, you know, that was intriguing.
This is ITV News at 10 with Julie Etchingham.
Good evening. The warmer weather of spring may give energy consumers a bit of a respite from the worst of the energy price increases as the heating goes off. But when winter comes around again and the nights get shorter, bills will be going up even more. The figure that the head of Ofgem put on it today was another £800 in October, pushing the price cap to £2,800. That's well over double what it was last October. In turn, it'll double the number of people really struggling to pay their bills, from 6 million to 12. That seems to have been enough to push the government into supporting the hardest hit, with an announcement expected as soon as this week.
The relative warmth of long spring days means April's record hike in gas and electricity prices is yet to be fully felt. But in the autumn, when dark nights set in and the temperatures fall, energy bills are set to skyrocket again, this time by even more, almost £900 more, the bleak news delivered to Parliament this afternoon.
This is a very distressing time for customers, but I do need to be clear with this committee, with customers and with the government about the likely price implications for October. We are expecting a price cap in October in the region of £2,800. This is going to be a big and difficult problem for the country to address. We need government to step in.
The hike, he said, was driven by a once-in-a-generation rise in global gas prices made worse by Russia's war in Ukraine. The energy cap, which limits what suppliers can charge, came in January 2019, set at just over £1,100 a year. And until recently, it stayed pretty much the same. But then in April, it rose dramatically to £1,971, up £700. In October, it's set to rise even more sharply to an average bill of £2,800 a year, and it could be even higher. In Scarborough, pensioner Chris Clark has already turned the heating off, but he's still struggling to pay his bills in the warmth of spring. Come the cold of autumn, he simply won't be able to afford them.
I'm scared. I don't know where cash is going to come in to go and support that sort of thing. It's not yet come to a choice over heat or eat, but with £2,800, it'll be a consideration for me, and I think for millions of others as well.
We understand the £10 billion package of help for Chris and millions like him could come as soon as Thursday, though today ministers were asking for patience.
You know, what we see now isn't the full picture. Both the Prime Minister and the Chancellor have said there's more to do, and we have to just wait and see what is forthcoming.
You think bill payers are happy with that answer, just wait and see?
No, look, it's a difficult time. We all know that people are under huge stress.
A windfall tax on energy firms is being considered, but the government is now being warned that won't be enough.
Government does need to think about things like expanding the warm home discount, so targeting support and giving people more support, particularly those who need it the most. The reality is, I think government's going to have to step in and help people because this is a huge crisis.
Ofgem warns October's rise will double the number of households in fuel poverty to 12 million. A staggering statistic, a fearful family behind each one, wondering how they're going to cope. Daniel Hewitt, News at 10.
And Robert joins me now to talk through this. And, you know, the head of Ofgem there used the word distressing. It will have been really frightening for a lot of families hearing this news today. What sort of package could be on the way to help those who need it most?
So I am expecting, possibly as soon as Thursday, some targeted help for those on the lowest incomes. And, you know, just to put that in perspective, the number of people who are going to really struggle to keep the lights on, keep the heating on this winter, the Resolution Foundation says just in England, we're talking about 10 million people. Now, my understanding is the government wants to give help of about £1,000 per family suffering that kind of hardship. We should put that into the context that energy bills alone have gone up or are going up between April and October, £1,500 a year. I mean, it's a staggering amount of money for almost anybody. Now, there has been a bit of help already, but that's been actually more broadly spread across the whole population. This is targeted help, probably for at least 10 million people. That'll cost about £10 billion. They haven't quite made up their minds about the delivery mechanism. It may be just a one-off payment through the benefit system. It might be through the Warm Homes discount. Talking to people in government, the final thing has not been sort of signed off yet, and you can sort of partly understand that because I'm going to hear later in the programme. There's another crisis going on to do with all these parties. Now, one of the things that I can't judge is whether the party's crisis tomorrow will be so great that this gets delayed yet again. The Prime Minister wants to get this announced on Thursday because he wants to prove that despite this party's crisis, he has got an agenda and he is moving forward with things that matter to people. I mean, finally, can I be absolutely confident that £1,000 is enough? Food bills are going up. The cost of everything is going up. This may still be only a down payment in what people actually need.
OK, Robert, thank you very much indeed for that. And let's move on then to the issue of the parties. And the Sue Gray report into what happened in and around Downing Street is now due, finally, tomorrow. She'll spell out her findings in detail in black and white. In the meantime, the photos of the Prime Minister at a Downing Street leaving party, which we showed yesterday, haven't just put more pressure on him, but on the Metropolitan Police too. The Labour Mayor of London, Sadiq Khan, has written to Scotland Yard to find out why Mr Johnson wasn't fined for being at that party when others were.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you very much.
The Prime Minister wanted to be seen getting on with the job at Cabinet today. In fact, jobs were all we heard him talk about as he avoids questions surrounding his own.
In fact, I don't want to let a single Cabinet go by without repeating that under this government, unemployment is now down to its lowest level since 1974.
Ministers banged the table in the building where staff had hit the alcohol, including the Prime Minister, seen raising a toast during lockdown in these photos we obtained yesterday, leaving others to explain the wine, spirits and speeches at this leaving do in November 2020.
In his mind, that didn't constitute a party. I see actually his ministerial work, his boxes in the background, the red boxes that he went from his office via there, asks to thank a member of staff who's leaving, raises a glass to them, says a few words and leaves.
Tomorrow, we'll finally hear Sue Gray's view of events that evening, as well as her verdict of the 15 other parties the civil servant's been investigating, with most Conservative MPs waiting for details before joining others in being damning.
Seriousness in government, seriousness in politics are fundamental to the security and protection of the British people. And I'm afraid when I see those photographs, it doesn't look serious, does it?
Neither does the investigation by the Metropolitan Police, according to the Mayor of London. Visiting the new Elizabeth line, he questioned the route officers took with their investigation, given they didn't find the Prime Minister for that leaving party.
It's really important, in my view, the Met Police explain how they reached their conclusions. Why? Because we're policed by consent. It's right and proper the public has confidence in policing.
As for confidence in the Prime Minister, well, today he welcomed the Emir of Qatar. But it's what arrives tomorrow that could determine how much longer Boris Johnson represents Britain. Paul Brand, News at 10.
And Anushka is in Downing Street for us tonight. So the Prime Minister's awaiting that report, as we all have been for so many months, from Sue Gray, Anushka. And tonight, details of another photo at another party.
Yeah, you'd be forgiven for losing count of the number of alleged events in Downing Street during lockdowns. The Met Police and Sue Gray have looked at plenty. But as you say, tonight, the Daily Mirror suggesting that there was another event on the 17th of November 2020, and they've got pictures of it, tables covered in bottles of alcohol, and a suggestion that WhatsApp messages were passed around saying the bar is open. Now, those revelations are quite similar to ones that we've heard before, and people around Boris Johnson say that all of this has been looked at by the police and by Sue Gray, but they are bracing themselves for a difficult day tomorrow. They know there will be more photographs in the report. In terms of MPs, I think they divide into two groups. Many who are just fed up of this and they want to move on. One said they'd withdrawn a letter of no confidence in the Prime Minister. And I actually just bumped into a close ally of the Prime Minister who looked pretty relaxed and said, there isn't any risk. This will go on and we will move on to other things. But others who feel that the atmosphere is grim. I've been speaking to MPs and even ministers today who are very worried about all of this. They feel like it is the nightmare that is not going away. And it isn't just Partygate that they are worried about. They're worried about other issues as well. They're worried about that response to the cost of living crisis. They're worried about a reshuffle that's coming up and hoping that it looks like a proper reset of the team. And they also want to know about electability, because the local elections were not easy and they know there are two by-elections coming up, one in the north and one in the southwest. They are very worried about them.
OK, Anushka, thank you very much indeed for that. Well, to a breaking story in the United States now, where there has been a terrible shooting this evening at a primary school in Texas. The state's governor says 14 children and their teacher have been killed. It happened in the southwest of the state, in Uvalde, at the Robb Elementary School. The gunman, an 18-year-old, is reported to have been shot dead by police.
We're coming on the air because of an awful scene playing out today in Texas. An active shooter for a time at an elementary school in Uvalde, Texas.
This is emerging late tonight as another horrific mass shooting. And adding to the agony, this took place either inside or close to a primary school, with multiple young children dead and injured.
He shot and killed horrifically, incomprehensibly, 14 students and killed a teacher. Mr. Romas, the shooter, he himself is deceased and is believed that responding officers killed him.
The details are still emerging, but these familiar and heartbreaking scenes show parents, children, and police officers running as they reacted to the unfolding situation. The attack occurred in the Texas town of Uvalde, south of Dallas. In its target and in the age of the victims, it is reminiscent of the attack on the Sandy Hook School in Connecticut in 2012. And it comes just days after the white supremacist assault on a supermarket in Buffalo in New York. So America is tonight grappling with fresh horror, its dimensions unclear. But the depth of America's crisis over mass shooting has never been more shockingly apparent. Robert Moore, News at 10, in the United States.
The latest on that terrible shooting in Texas. More of the intense secrecy surrounding how China is treating its mainly Muslim Uyghur population has today been blown apart by the hacking of Chinese police files. They confirm thousands are being held in so-called re-education camps and prisons with long sentences. For example, 16 years for nothing more serious than growing a beard. The files have been leaked just as a United Nations team begins a fact-finding mission in China.
It is haunting to look at their faces and know their only crime was their ethnicity. From a boy and girl aged just 15 to these two elderly women aged 73, they were all held in detention camps in Xinjiang, their fates unknown. One brave person stole these images from police records to reveal to the world the extent of China's ethnic cleansing. The unprecedented cache of documents shows at least 2 million Uyghurs, that's 10% of the population, were or still are being detained. Rahima hasn't heard from her family since 2017.
It's heartbreaking to see those photos of elderly, young, including children. It is not re-education. It is not vocational training. It is concentration camps. It's worse than prison. Many people said it's worse than prison.
The anonymous source of the hacked files is now in hiding, having exposed damning details of orders that came directly from President Xi. A 2018 speech from a security official states General Secretary Xi has given important instructions for increasing the number of staff positions, enlarging the capacity, and increasing investment in detention facilities. It is rare confirmation that the president was not only aware, but directing the campaign. Yerba Ko was released from a re-education camp in 2019. He recognized the images taken from police drills of suspects being hooded and shackled. And he knew of a shoot-to-kill order on anyone trying to escape.
When they transferred us from prison to prison or taken us for questioning in the interrogation room, they escort you with an automatic rifle. They shackle your hands and feet, place a black hood over your head.
The revelations were timed to coincide with the arrival of the UN High Commissioner in China for her long-awaited visit to Xinjiang. She told the foreign minister she hopes to advance cooperation on human rights, but she will be chaperoned throughout the week and unable to conduct a truly independent investigation. The government continues to reject all claims of genocide.
The US, Britain and other Western countries have been repeatedly staging political farces around the UN High Commissioner for Human Rights' visit to China. They have first openly pressured and strongly demanded that the High Commissioner visit China and Xinjiang and conducted the so-called investigation with presumption of guilt.
The denials will continue, but so too does the evidence keep stacking up. Debbie Edward, News at 10, Beijing.
After seeing the pictures last summer of the evacuation airlifts from Afghanistan, it's perhaps no wonder that MPs investigating what happened have talked of deep failures, disaster and a betrayal of Britain's Afghan allies. In their report, the MPs describe a total absence of a plan for Afghans who supported British forces when Taliban fighters started winning back land. The MPs say the Foreign Office should have seen it coming and now should still be focused on the consequences.
Nearly a year ago, and within just a few weeks, two decades of Britain's commitment to Afghanistan simply evaporated. Afghan allies left behind besieged us for help. Almost none came. One of those is Fazl. He fled Afghanistan when the Taliban took over and is now living illegally in a third country. He says Britain owes him the right to sanctuary, which it isn't fulfilling.
I have 100% tried to come to UK. I told you, I sacrifice my blood, myself, my bones for the British people. I got bullets in my hand. I got bullets on my shoulder. I got stabbed by a knife. Why? I have just one message to please help me and take me out from this stress and depression.
The report says the fact that the Prime Minister, the then Foreign Secretary Dominic Raab, and the Foreign Office's top civil servant, Sir Philip Barton, were all on leave when the Taliban took over showed a lack of seriousness and leadership. The report bluntly says that Sir Philip should consider his position. It says the UK's botched evacuation of Afghan allies and British passport holders likely cost lives. And, as a result, the UK will now face a heightened terror threat from Afghanistan.
Morrison, to get us out here,
but this report's most damning findings aren't about what happened a year ago, as terrible a failure as that was. It's also about what's happened since, to the Afghans left behind to face the Taliban takeover, and who are now being hunted and killed. Ash Alexander Cooper was a colonel who served for 4 years in Afghanistan. He is in constant touch with dozens of Afghans who served alongside him.
Would you trust us if we made commitments again? I think it's really damaged our standing in the world.
What's the reality for people that you know who've been left behind in Afghanistan who once served us?
My phone is full of pretty graphic images of murders and torture and, you know, just beatings, you know, in the best case. And it's very real for them. You know, clearly, I'm in a safe place in the UK, but the reality for them, they are terrified and they don't know what to do. They're relying on words issued by this government last August, and we've yet to deliver on that, and that's tragic.
The consequences of our rushed and botched exit from Afghanistan continues to cost lives and futures. The Taliban have ended teenage girls' education, forced women to cover up in public, and all this in the midst of the worst humanitarian crisis in Afghan living memory.
Raghiam, on News at 10.
When 12-year-old Ava White went to see the Christmas lights in Liverpool city centre last year, she never returned home. Today, a 14-year-old boy was found guilty of Ava's murder, stabbing her to death in a row about filming a social media video of her. Ava was with friends that night, having the time of her life, the prosecution said, when she was stabbed in the neck. There were cheers in court from 20 members of her family when the guilty verdict was announced. The boy cried. He'll be sentenced in July. He can't be named because of his age. The prospect of serious disruption to the rail network right across Britain came a big step closer tonight. The Railway Workers' Union, the RMT, has announced that its members have voted overwhelmingly for a strike in a bitter dispute over jobs, pay and conditions. If it goes ahead as planned, it would bring huge parts of the network to a standstill. Last time Meghan Markle's father Thomas was due to come to Britain for her marriage to Prince Harry, he was taken ill, and now it seems it's happened again. Mr Markle is reported to be in hospital after having a stroke. He was due to fly over from his home in Mexico for the Platinum Jubilee weekend. He'd hoped to meet his grandchildren, Archie and Libbert, for the first time. Now, it's still not clear what factor or factors are causing an unusual rise in hepatitis and liver damage in children. There are currently around 200 cases. What is clear is that a few of those children ended up needing liver transplants with all the fear and worry that means for their families.
You go down the slide, see Mum?
Fia's parents are grateful every single day they get to watch their daughter playing.
Natasha, did you ever think that you'd see this? A few weeks ago.
Oh God, I know. I could only like really dream about something like this a few weeks ago.
Fia, come see Dad.
This was Fia a few weeks ago, learning to walk again after having a liver transplant. She contracted hepatitis before Easter and became so ill her liver began to fail.
They did say there's a possibility that she could require a liver transplant. It was really hard. The nurses were great. Like, so there was a day where I remember just sitting like, couldn't really come to terms with it. It was really hard, and they would just talk to you, they'd be really cute.
It changed the dynamic, because at that point you were thinking about she's going to recover herself. It then changed the dynamic to the fact that, right, we're in a place where she's not going to recover by herself, and we now need to change the dynamic. We're obviously getting a new liver.
The wait, though, to find a donor was agonising.
I just sort of fell apart in her arms. It was like she can't die. Like, what would we do without her? Like, when she was first born, I remember saying that, like, oh my God, I can't believe we get to keep her forever. You know, like, we made this little thing, we get to keep her. And all of a sudden, it was like that wasn't going to happen anymore.
Fia is one of 197 children who've contracted hepatitis in the last few months. 11 have needed transplants. She was treated here at Birmingham Children's Hospital.
Fia is now needing monitoring to make sure that her new liver is functioning well. So for the families, this is very difficult. These are really very well children who don't have any illnesses before they develop this jaundice.
It's why health officials are desperately trying to find out why there's been a rise in cases. Most are certain it's due to the pandemic and working on three theories.
One is that these very young children were infected with COVID at some stage, and that the COVID damaged their livers, making them susceptible to these normally fairly harmless viruses. The second possibility is that they were also infected by COVID, but it damaged their immune systems. And the third possibility is that these children, because they were so young, did not develop their normal immunity because they were not exposed to everyday viruses during the lockdowns.
They've thought about it endlessly, but Natasha and Alistair have no idea how or why fear caught the virus.
We thought, how has it came into our body? What could we have done? Is it something we've been or something we've done that's potentially had this? But the doctors right at the start was like, look, you can't, we don't know. So you can't be thinking about something you've done.
For now, both are just focused on Fia's recovery and coming to terms with the idea they still have her to keep. Emily Morgan, News at 10 in Belfast.
The end of the Roman Abramovich era at Chelsea Football Club edged a little bit closer today. The Premier League has agreed the proposed takeover of the club by their preferred bidders, led by a Californian investment bank. That doesn't mean the deal is done. Not yet. The government has to give its approval too. And finally, as all ABBA fans know, the group haven't done a concert in person in 40 years. Sorry to disappoint, but they're not about to. But Benny and Bjorn have been talking to us about the next best thing, the group's upcoming Avatar shows, which kick off on Friday in their own arena in London. The Avatars sing and dance like they did back in the day. Magical, Benny called it. But then, of course, he's hoping fans will take a chance and go and see it.
It's the ABBA of old, but in a way that's very new. They've been working for years on bringing their iconic musical catalogue back to the stage through these digital versions of themselves. This week, it's finally happening.
It's very hard to describe what it is because nobody has ever done it before. It's a strange, wonderful thing when those voices come out of those lips and those faces, something very special happens.
The Swedish pop legends use motion capture technology to create avatars, or as they're being called, abatars.
It's really, really magical what they've achieved. It's like witchcraft. The fact that you can be on stage at the same time as you're out home walking the dog, You know, that was intriguing.
Sometimes they're shocked that it's not really them performing.
It's avatars of us alongside the musicians. And I get the illusion there must be someone up there. They're there, you know.
Although ABBA isn't actually live, the backing music is. Benny and Bjorn will be watching closely.
I'll pop over every now and then, have to check that the band is disciplined and not, jumping their guns. Yeah. Starting to, when they get bored, new bass lines and things, can't have that.
No. Back to the old ones.
I know it's probably too soon to ask, but what's next for ABBA?
After this?
You've done this.
This is it, man. No.
But the avatars, they might be in for new adventures, who knows?
With so many hits to choose from, it's been tricky to compile the perfect list of songs.
They're getting a lot of the ABBA hits done in a new way.
And also some songs they haven't, that are not so familiar to everyone, that we choose because we like them. So we put them in. But Dancing Queen is in. I promise.
So while the real ABBA's career may be winding down, for their digital counterparts, things are just getting started. Rishi Davda, News at 10.
Now back to tonight's breaking news of a school shooting in Texas and the latest detail we're getting from there. The state's governor says 15 people have been killed. 14 were children aged between 5 and 11. One of them was a teacher. It happened in Uvalde in the southwest of the state at the Robb Elementary School. The 18-year-old gunman has been shot dead by the police. These are then the latest images. More details as they come in will be on our website. As once again in America, the grieving and the soul searching begins. So a hard story to end on tonight. We'll be back tomorrow with all the latest from Texas and, of course, the fallout from the Sue Gray report. Until then, good night. We'll see you tomorrow.
of Morning Britain, the boy who disappeared down the drain. We meet the toddler and his saviour mother after their terrifying ordeal.
Cold outside, remember, I know that it's cold outside.
Big Nasty on backing the next big thing. And Anastasia talks about why she's out of lockdown. Tomorrow from 6 on Good Morning Britain.
It's going to be hot, so you may be tempted to go for a dunk later. Heinz garlic sauce.